All right, guys, today I plan to talk about making a loading plan for containers. This video pertains to container ships only, but we'll talk about the considerations that are kept in mind or that are borne for loading normal containers, reefer containers, or containers carrying dangerous goods. So this video will be very useful for you guys who are going for any kind of orals or written examination, mariners who are going for examination, and especially if you have never sailed on container ships, you may be asked questions about container ships in your oral examination. So watch this video, let me know what you think about it. Let's get started. So some of the considerations that are kept in mind before you start planning the loading of containers. Before I start with this, I must tell you that the container planning is normally done ashore. I've made a video on that as well, and I've explained how it is done ashore. But at the end of the day, it is left to the discretion of the master and the chief officer, who are legally allowed to make any changes as they feel suitable or as they deem suitable, which will keep the ship safe, or their stack weight will not be exceeded, or the lashing plan is adhered to, or the cargo is loaded as per the designed of the ship. So let's get started. So the first point that is considered for loading of containers is the port rotation, of course. So usually the first port of discharge is on top. So containers should be accessible with regards to the port of discharge, or the order of which the port of discharge will be encountered or experienced during a voyage. Now, normally any kind of shifting is frowned upon, because any container, if it has to be shifted to get access to the port of discharge containers, then that will cost money to the ship owner. So that is frowned upon. So containers are stored as per the port of discharge with minimum or zero shifting to be required. But of course, in certain extreme cases, we also have cases where some containers may have to be shifted to get access to the containers for the port of discharge. Then flexibility is kept in mind. So like I said, minimum shifting and ability to load or discharge at subsequent ports is managed. So containers should be managed in such a way that sequential discharge as per the sequence of the port of discharges can be maintained. Then the draft and trim are of course considered. So consider the port limitations. So especially make sure that you do not exceed the load lines for the seasons in which the ports are located. So if you are in a tropical port, do not exceed the tropical load line. If you're on summer port, do not exceed the summer load line. So at the end of the day, after the loading is finished, you must make sure that the draft and the trim does not exceed the load lines, or the draft is sufficient for sailing to take place, or for it provides the draft is suitable for the depth of water available for sailing. Distribute the heavy and light containers as required, because normally heavy containers go into the under the deck cargo, so it goes inside the hold, and the light containers or the empty containers are kept on deck. But of course, considerations have to be given to the port rotation, like I said before, and some port slots are distributed forward and aft as well. In terms of bending moments and shearing forces, make sure that you avoid empty and heavy boxes in adjacent bays, because that pretty much leads to uneven bending moments and shearing forces, which adds to the stress experienced by the ship, especially during the voyage, and especially if the ship encounters heavy seas during the voyage, then this unequal or uneven distribution of weights will lead to hogging and sagging, which is not good for the ship safety. Then keep in mind the torsional stresses as well that the ship experiences, and this also results due to uneven loading, but along the forward and aft line. Even though the ship may be upright after the loading, but if there is uneven loading along the forward and aft line, if you put in too many containers in the forward part and too less in the aft, or vice versa, then torsional stress may lead to may occur. Remember, torsional stresses, the effect is more due to the longer length of the longer the length of the vessel, higher the free beam and the freeboard, that will lead to more torsional stresses, especially if there is uneven weight distribution. So make sure, therefore, distribution of slots is done equally on port and starboard sides. If required, use the ballast judiciously to overcome the problem. So make sure that you have ballast at hand, and that can be used to that can aid in the weight distribution on the ship. Remember, torsional moment is calculated by multiplying the stack weight and the distance from the center line, distance where the container has loaded from the center line. So if you multiply these, so if you multiply the moments on the starboard side and the moments on the port side, ideally they should be near to equal. So difference between port and starboard moments give the torsion at that point. So if you can multiply the port moments and the starboard moments separately, and if the values are very close, that will be good for the vessel, of course. Then other points that are considered is the stack weight as well as the block weight. So make sure that maximum weight that can be borne by the deck is the stack weight, of course, and hatch covers, tank tops, they are all considered. So make sure that maximum stack weight is not exceeded. Stack weight is mentioned in the cargo loading manual, and when you put in the weight of the containers in the loadicator, it shows there as well. So avoid excessive weights by mixing the heavy and light boxes. Like I said before, heavy boxes go under the deck, and that also helps in the getting an adequate GM, and the light boxes and the empty boxes stay on the top or over the deck or on the weather deck. Then think about the container sizes, 20 feet, 40 feet. There are also 45 feet containers which can only be loaded on top of 40 feet. So make sure that the containers as per the sizes go into the right slots. Some cargo holds may be designed to only take 40 feet or only take 20 feet containers. So make sure that you have you're familiar with that. Some ships, I'm not saying all ships, but some ships or some ships on deck, you can only load 40 feet in certain places and not 20 feet. So make sure that you're very aware of that, and vice versa, of course. Then think about the type of containers as well. So reefers should be loaded close to the position where the reefer plugs are available. Similarly, containers carrying dangerous goods as per the IMDG code are loaded only in designated places. So every ship has a document of compliance which is issued as per the ship's suitability to load dangerous goods, and in that some designated holds and designated spaces are provided for the ship sometimes where the dangerous cargo may be loaded, and you must comply with that as well. Then the type of cargo also should be considered. So for example, if you're carrying anything valuable cargoes which may be prone to pilferage, so make sure, of course, containers are well locked and sealed, but make sure that such containers are stored in a position which can be protected from pilferage. So that would, the best place would be, of course, to go under the deck to make sure that it is not accessible to shore personnel for any kind of theft or pilferage. Then of course, stability is as normally required for all ships. Stability of the vessel should be considered. Like I said, if the container loading plan has been made ashore, then all the details can be fed into the loadicator and checked. If it is fine, then of course you can approve the plan, but if you feel that something is not right, then you can legally change the container plan as per the stability requirements or the stack weight requirements or the lashing requirements, because you know your ship best. In terms of reefer containers, now in terms of reefer containers, there are some additional considerations that should be borne or that should be kept in mind. So the container will, the reefer container normally uses either a 220 volt or a 440 volt plug point and operates within a temperature range of say about -24 to -25 to +25 degrees Celsius. So make sure that sufficient spares are carried on board if you are carrying reefers, so that if there is any damage or if there is any malfunctioning, then they can be repaired. Consider the plug positions and the maximum number of reefers allowed at certain bays or cargo holds, and only because sometimes the shore personnel may not be aware of it, or they may have overlooked this fact that you are loading more reefers than the plug points available. So make sure that you load the reefers as per the plug points available. Sometimes you may get extensions, but then make sure that you discuss it with the ship's electrician as well as the shore authorities to ensure that that will be suffice for your ship. Deck stowage should be on lowest tier to facilitate repairs. So if you are carrying reefers, do not load them more than one or two high, because that then it is accessible for seafarers or mariners to carry out any repairs. If loaded higher, then of course it becomes a bit unsafe, and also sometimes the plug points or the wires for the plug points are not sufficient to reach the reefer points. Multiple socket connections should not be used. Sometimes I have seen them being used, but that should be avoided, because if there is any voltage fluctuations, then reefer cargoes or reefer ships, reefer containers may spoil or may damage, get damaged or stop working, malfunction, and then that will be trouble for the cargo. The load port must be informed of the plug position so that boxes are loaded correctly. Now normally they have details of your vessel, but sometimes they overlook and they forget. about this essential detail when they are loading reefers. For reefers, make sure that immediately after loading you are checking that the machinery is working. The ship's electrician is very handy when it comes to this, so he or she can be called and asked to cross check along with you as the loading officer, and check that the temperature reading and compare with the set value as per the reefer manifest. The container should show the temperature. It takes time to reach that temperature because it has been unplugged for some time and then it is loaded on the ship. But once it is loaded on the ship, after a certain period of time, make sure that the temperature on the reefer container is the same as that specified for the cargo being carried. If the difference becomes too much, then you may refuse to load the box, or you may even lodge a protest or ask the ship's electrician to have a look to make sure that it is working properly. Check the part load chart. That is a temperature chart that you can also see on your screen, for any difference between actual temperature as shown by the LED display or the digital display, and that being recorded on the part load chart. Once the container is loaded, you have to make proper entries on the part load chart. That may include the date and time, the voyage, the port of loading, and any other details that you feel is important. Check the ventilator settings so that if the cooling system that is adding air from the top and extracting from the bottom is working properly, and the container should of course be lashed as per the approved lashing manual. Also, during the voyage, make sure that daily checks on the temperature are being carried out as per company instructions, and these temperatures should be logged in the reefer logbook so that evidence can be shown towards the monitoring of reefers during the voyage, especially if at discharge port, if there are any claims or any claims after sailing out from the discharge port, then you have the reefer monitoring sheets to be provided as an evidence of cargo being monitored during the voyage. Some ships also have electronic systems with alarms on bridge or in cargo control rooms, so that should be monitored as well. And on arrival discharge port, make sure that you disconnect reefers, but make a remark on the part load chart as to what time you disconnected it, what was the temperature at that point of time, voyage, any other details if you feel is important. For loading containers with dangerous goods in them, some additional considerations is that the vessel should have a document of clearance or a DOC as per the SOLAS convention. So only vessels which have a document of compliance, not clearance, but document of compliance to load dangerous goods container should load dangerous goods. The IMDG cargo, the dangerous goods cargo, will be loaded, packed, segregated inside the container as per the requirements for the packaged cargo given in the IMDG code by the shipper. So IMDG code stands for International Maritime Dangerous Goods Code, and based on the kind of cargo that you are carrying, they specify the kind of packaging required and segregation required, and that's how it is done inside the container. The shipper should provide comprehensive cargo information as per the SOLAS convention, and when we say comprehensive cargo information, that basically means that a shipper provides a dangerous goods manifest. A dangerous goods manifest is separate from a container manifest because it contains details of the cargo being carried and all its properties and special care to be taken, the information of which is normally taken from the IMDG code. Along with that, a signed container packing certificate is also provided. Containers packed, marked, labeled and placarded accordingly. So when we say marked and labeled and placarded, normally a container carrying dangerous goods is placarded with the appropriate class of cargo on all the four sides of the container, so that it is known to the mariners as to what kind of cargo they are being carried and what class of cargo is being carried, because sometimes with any kind of leakage or if there are any issues with the container, the mariners should be aware of the properties of the cargo. Do not accept the container if there is any doubt about the packing certificate. A cargo manifest, like I said, a DG manifest should be provided as per the FAL form. So if you don't know what FAL is Facilitation of Maritime Traffic. It's a convention on facilitation of maritime traffic. So as per the convention or a FAL convention, there is a manifest form available for dangerous goods, and that should be filled and provided to the ship's master. So like you can see on the screen, your container should be marked on both, on all the four sides with the IMDG label. It's called the DG label. And you can see the DG label basically shows the class of cargo as specified by the IMDG code. So the shipper's declaration also includes the cargo contents, the name, UN number, class, weight, container number, etc. All this information is provided in the IMDG code as well. The cargo segregation for the containers having the dangerous goods inside them should be done as per the IMDG code, so that to make sure that no cargo gets tainted. So if you have non-compatible cargos packed together in the same container, they may get tainted, because some containers, for example, they release fumes or they release flammable vapors, which may damage the cargo which is not compatible, or may another cargo may actually self spontaneously ignite itself and damage other cargoes in the vicinity. So such cargoes should be segregated from each other. Make sure that you study the individual schedule for the cargo given in volume 2 of the IMDG code, and you also identify the EMS, which is the emergency schedule, and the MFAG table, that's the medical first aid guide tables, and study the cargo precautions and properties. And especially if you are carrying dangerous goods on the ship, you must study these, because some goods may require additional equipment to be carried. For example, let's say if you may have to carry additional face masks or resuscitators, if there is any kind of leakage of cargo and you have to go and handle that cargo, you have to clean that cargo may be giving off dangerous fumes or vapors, which if you inhale may lead to death or serious injury. So in that case, you may have to carry extra masks or resuscitators or oxygen cylinders or something like that. Make sure that you read up on the schedule of the IMDG code for the specific cargo that you're carrying, and you should have all the equipment necessary to protect yourself on the ship. If not, then you can order for these equipments. So make sure that the vessel carries any additional safety equipment required by the emergency schedule as defined in the IMDG code. For example, chemical exposure suits, extra self-contained breathing apparatus, medicines, gas detectors, etc. The IMDG cargo container loading plan should be load planned and stored as per the IMDG code, the port, and the company requirements. If the chief officer does not have sufficient time to check due to short port stay, make sure to take a signed declaration from the shore planner regarding the stowage and segregation of IMDG boxes. Prior to loading, ensure that emergency equipment is in readiness, and duty officer also has an IMDG container stowage plan. So ideally, give a separate plan to the duty officer for the IMDG goods, where the stowage and the class of the cargo is clearly labeled. Ensure that the containers being loaded have the markings on the labels, and visually check for any kind of smoke, fumes, leaks, improper stowage, or broken seals, etc. once the container has been loaded. You can also check for it in the shore side, but sometimes it's not possible. So once it is loaded on the ship, you should make a check for these, because if it's damaged, then you can ask the you can refuse to load this container, or even lodge a note of protest from the master's side. The stowage plan for the IMDG and the related emergency schedules and medical first aid guide procedures should be kept in the cargo control room, the fire control room, the bridge, and sometimes it's also kept along with the fire plan, because if there is any fire in any subsequent ports, then you may use the details of the IMDG goods that you are carrying on your ship and update the shore firefighting authorities if they come on board to help you fight the fire. It will also help you if the ship catches or the cargo catches fire at sea, then it's a good reminder for you to be aware of the cargo that has caught fire and what are its properties, because some of these goods, if they catch fire, they cannot be extinguished by water. If you put water on them, the situation may become worse. So these goods may have to be handled differently, for example, through foam or through some other means, such as fixed firefighting extinguishing systems, so on and so forth. Emergency drills should be carried out with respect to situations involving dangerous goods containers, like leaks, fires, explosions. So one of your fire drills could be based on such a scenario where a dangerous goods container has caught fire. So make sure you carry out such drills and make a log of these drills, and this should form part of the documentation for the ISM code as well. Keep a daily check on the dangerous goods container during the voyage as well, as you would do for reefer containers. So make sure that there are no leakages or any smoke coming out or any powders coming out, because in the past I have faced a scenario where some dangerous goods leaked, and cleaning operations had to be carried out. For that, you have to be very aware of what kind of cargo you are carrying. Alright, that's pretty much it, guys. I hope this video was useful for you. Like I said, this video is very useful for those of you who have never sailed on container ships but maybe asked questions about them in your OLS examination. Thanks, guys, and bye for now.